For everyone who's joining us, this is the GU Oncology review of the conference highlights from ESMO 2024. For this part of our discussion, we'll be reviewing the kidney cancer updates from ESMO 2024. My name is Vincent Xu, medical oncologist at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute, and joining me as a discussant is Dr. Tony Shuweri. ESMO 2024 kidney cancer abstracts, we saw that there is no benefit for adding nivolumab to tivozanib after prior immunotherapy in metastatic advanced RCC. We also saw that ipi-nivo had a 12-month overall survival benefit among a randomized trial of patients with RCC and divergent histologies. We saw yet another phase 3 IO-TKI combination in RCC, and we have some important updates on HIF-2 alpha inhibitors and novel mechanisms. We'll start with the TNIVO-2 study. This was a randomized trial of tivozanib plus nivolumab versus tivozanib monotherapy in patients with RCC who had received prior immune checkpoint inhibitor. We know from the prior CONTACT-3 study that cabozantinib plus atezolizumab was not superior to cabozantinib in patients who had received prior immunotherapy. The TNIVO-2 study asked a similar question, but with a PD-1 inhibitor instead of a PD-L1 inhibitor. Patients with locally advanced or metastatic RCC and who had progressed after prior immunotherapy were randomized to tivozanib and nivolumab or tivozanib alone. Of note, the dose of tivozanib was different in the two arms, and it was higher in the monotherapy arm. This was due to potential concern for hypertension with combination therapy. Patients were stratified by prior therapy, including by whether the most recent line of therapy was immune checkpoint or not. Adjuvant immunotherapy was allowed on this trial. Going straight to the results, centrally reviewed PFS was not different between the two arms. In the ITT population, hazard ratio was 1.1 for PFS with a p-value of 0.49. And looking at subgroups, PFS was not different among any of the subgroups. Consistent with the PFS, overall survival was also not different for tivozanib plus nivolumab versus tivozanib, with a p-value of essentially 1 and a hazard ratio of 1.00. Looking at the adverse events, it was interesting to point out that the tivozanib-related adverse events were more common in the monotherapy arm, which is consistent with a higher dose of tivozanib among patients receiving monotherapy. In summary, TNIVO-2 is the second trial that shows that there's no benefit to adding immunotherapy after patients have progressed on prior immunotherapy. There was no benefit for adding nivolumab to tivozanib. Consistent with prior results, we should not be using IO-TKI combinations in patients who recently progressed on immunotherapy. This trial does show that tivozanib is a reasonable option in refractory RCC with a 20% overall response rate after prior ICI. Although it's hard to compare this trial directly to CONTACT-3, but for the record, CONTACT-3, cabozantinib, had approximately a 41% overall response rate. Next, we have a potentially practice-changing trial. This was the SUNY Forecast trial, a prospective randomized phase 2 trial of ipi-nivo versus standard of care in non-clear cell RCC. SUNY Forecast randomized patients with divergent histology RCC, which consisted of predominantly papillary RCC with a significant minority of patients with chromophobe RCC. Patients were randomized to either ipi-nivo followed by nivolumab maintenance or to standard of care. In this trial, standard of care was mostly single agent TKI. Some patients received sunitinib, fewer patients received cabozantinib, and a very few patients received IO-TKI combinations. This trial was the first randomized trial to evaluate ipi-nivo in non-clear cell RCC. Again, I want to point out that close to 60% of patients had papillary RCC and almost 20% of patients had chromophobe RCC. There was about 4.5% sarcomatoid features. This trial met its primary endpoint, I apologize for the typo. It's 12-month OS, not 21-month OS. 12-month OS was superior for ipi-nivo compared to standard of care with a p-value of 0.01. However, overall survival rate at 6 months and 18 months and overall did not meet statistical significance. Looking at the subgroup analyses, PD-L1 did appear to enrich for benefit from ipi-nivo, with more benefit seen among patients who are PD-L1 positive. There was benefit from ipi-nivo among patients with chromophobe RCC, as well as the overall population. Looking at the SUNY forecast results in context, ipi-nivo had an overall response rate in this trial of 33%. This randomized trial does establish ipi-nivo as a reasonable treatment option in RCC patients with divergent histologies and non-clear cell. The 26% overall response rate for ipi-nivo in chromophobe RCC is intriguing and potentially shows that pure IO regimens can work in a subset of chromophobe RCC patients. The bottom table shows this data in context with recent combination therapies. And I want to point out that there were significant response rates seen with other immunotherapy combinations, including cabo-atezo, cabo-nivo, and len-pembro, which all remain reasonable options as well. Next, we have a randomized phase 3 study, and lotnib combined with anti-PD-L1, which is benmelstobart, versus sunitinib. This is another IOTKI versus sunitinib randomized trial, predominantly was done in China. The background for this is that belmensostart is an anti-PD-L1 and enlotinib is a VEGF-TKI. Both are already approved in China for other indications, including non-small cell lung cancer. In this study, previously untreated patients with metastatic clear cell RCC were randomized to the combination or to sunitinib. PFS was the primary endpoint. This trial did meet its PFS endpoint with a hazard ratio of 0.53 and a significant p-value favoring the combination arm. The response rate was 72% for the combination versus 25% for sunitinib. I do want to point out that for an immunotherapy combination, there was a surprisingly low CR rate with a complete response rate of only 1%. Overall survival was not mature, but not statistically significant, although favoring the combination arm at the time of the data cutoff. In summary, this new PD-L1 plus TKI combination shows PFS benefit versus sunitinib. Given the existing landscape and the lack of OS benefit, it's very unlikely that this combination is going to see widespread use in the United States or Western Europe, but it could be relevant in other countries, and especially in China. And this could sit in a similar space with axitinib plus toripalimab, which was recently also presented. Next, we have some fascinating fecal microbiota data. We have preliminary results of the randomized phase 2 Tacito trial. The background for this is that we know the gut microbiome is very important for ICI response in RCC and also actually for other diseases. We have several prior randomized phase 1 trials showing that this active microbial product, CBM588, seems to improve outcomes when added to cabo-nivo or to ipi-nivo. This trial investigated whether transplantation of fecal microbiome from a responding patient might improve responses to ICI. In this trial, patients were all receiving axitinib plus pembrolizumab for first-line treatment of RCC. Patients with clear cell or non-clear cell were eligible for this trial. Patients were randomized to axi-pembro in combination with placebo or in combination with fecal microbiome transplantation. The transplantation was done in 3 steps, first by colonoscopy, then with 2 oral capsule delivery regimens. The primary endpoint was PFS at 1 year. This trial met its primary endpoint. Progression-free survival was 67% versus 35% for FMT versus placebo. looking at secondary endpoints, progression-free survival, and overall survival also favored the combination therapy. The overall response rate was 52% for FMT versus 28% for placebo. This is an interesting study and adds to the literature of several small randomized trials showing the microbiome is active in RCC. There were no severe adverse events from fecal microbiota transfer. However, it is kind of intriguing that there was only a 28% overall response rate in the placebo arm for axi-pembro, much lower than expected. This is consistent with prior phase one randomized studies where it seems like the control arm for these microbiome studies seems to fare worse compared to the prior phase three data, and does raise the question that this data needs to be confirmed in larger randomized studies. Next, we have important overall survival analysis of LITESPARK-005. This is the final analysis of this pivotal data that led to the approval of belzutifan. LITESPARK-005 randomized patients with advanced or metastatic clear cell RCC with 1 to 3 prior treatment regimens. Patients were randomized to belzutifan or to everolimus. The results of this study were previously presented showing PFS and overall response rate superior for belzutifan versus everolimus and already led to FDA approval for belzutifan in clear cell RCC. In this final data cutoff, overall survival benefit was not statistically significant for belzutifan, although the hazard ratio of 0.92 did favor belzutifan. With this data, belzutifan remains an important treatment option in patients with refractory clear cell RCC, given the PFS benefit, higher overall response rate, and overall favorable toxicity profile of this drug. We have some interesting data from a novel HIF-2 alpha inhibitor, NKT2152. This is an oral HIF-2 alpha inhibitor. And in this first data release, we saw that there was a 20% overall response rate among patients who were heavily pretreated. This drug is different from belzutifan and distinguished by its extremely long half-life. The half-life was 38 days, which is potentially a double-edged sword. In the one hand, this drug can have sustained inhibition of HIF-2 alpha. On the other hand, patients who experience toxicity may have this drug circulating for quite a long time. It remains to be seen to see how this performs in other cohorts, and we did accrue a lot of patients to NKT2152 here at Dana-Farber, including to a post-belzutifan cohort. So that data remains to be seen. Next, and finally, we have some interesting biomarker data from Dr. Braun looking at glycoproteomic biomarkers in CheckMate 9ER, Cabo, Nevo versus sunitinib. As we all remember, CheckMate 9ER established cabozantinib and nivolumab as a first-line treatment regimen in clear cell RCC. In this interesting glycoproteomic analysis, Dr. Braun and colleagues looked at glycopeptides and showed that there are some glycopeptides that appear to be associated with enrichment for response on cabo-nivo. Specifically, complement protein 3 glycopeptide was associated with improved progression-free survival, and complement factor H glycopeptide was associated with poor progression-free survival. This is a new kind of circulating biomarker and needs to be validated in future studies. There are plans to use the same platform, which is Interven, glycoproteomic analysis in future studies, and this could be a new avenue for biomarker discovery. And with that, I'll turn it over to Dr. Tony Schueri.
Starting with DNevo2, I think this is the nail in the coffin of rechallenging with PD-1, PD-L1 inhibitor. This is a practice that's seen in multiple malignancy. Sadly, there is no trials that is a phase 3 that has been done in any tumor except in renal cell cancer. So immune checkpoint inhibitors are used in melanoma, bladder, you name it, lung cancer. But you don't find a trial A plus PD-1 versus A post-progression on prior PD-1 doesn't exist. There's a randomized phase 2 with Nevo-Ipi actually as the experimental arm versus ipi and prior PD-1 failure. It's a small randomized phase two that is positive, but no phase three like that. And melanoma is quite different. The biology is quite different for checkpoint inhibitor and CTLA-4 inhibitors. So this is the second totally negative waste of resources, increased toxicity. It's possible that the lower dose of bevacizumab we use because of the hypertension, led to a improvement in PFS in the control arm, but post PD-1 inhibitor PFS with bevacizumab close to 10 months is quite intriguing. So that's one. The second study, we saw another PD-1 based study repeating what we have done over 5 years ago from China following the toparilimab study, which was done last year. Same thing. I don't know, these drugs are approved in China. We see second opinion from China with this PD-1 inhibitor. Are they interchangeable? I don't know. They're beating the TKI we don't use as control arm. Long time ago, we haven't used sunitinib. They're beating it and sometimes having an OS benefit, which let me think about the availability of other checkpoint inhibitor. Doesn't concern us a lot, but probably concern globally. More patients in China will be treated with renal cell cancer based on the just numbers. Also, it's less common overall cancer in China than in the US.